here to Fitzgerald Hall. It's been a bit of shifting and moving, and I'll talk to us a bit later about the fact that we're going to continue to shift and move for a few more weeks yet at the end. But special welcome as well if you are visiting with us today for the first time. It's not new for you, so in the sense of the venue, but we're really glad that you could be here. And I do want to say hello to those on the live stream as well. So if you are sick, you can join us on the live stream. But last weekend, for my family, it was kind of a special time for us. We got the chance to go down to Brisbane, and our eldest daughter was in a school marching band down there in Brisbane CBD, and she's been doing that trip for 3 or 4 years. This was the year we finally got to go down and see it in person. Happened to also be the year when we had another son, Cade, who was fairly involved in the marching that happened here in town as well for the Anzac Day services. But it was a special time for us. But it was interesting being in Brisbane, because as I rocked up for that Anzac Day march, as we went along to it, there were almost, at least as I saw it, no signs of the whole COVID thing. I didn't see any sign-in forms. Maybe I missed them. There are a few others there with us. But it even took me a while until I saw someone in a mask. And so it was like this feeling of a return to some level of normality. And even as we watched those marches going by, I mean, it's a celebration on one level, remembering, of course, the horrors of war in the past, but also remembering the cost at which this peace that we enjoy has come. And even to see the army marching around, the current day military, this kind of sign of kind of just security. And so it was this special weekend. Then you come back this week, and I don't know about you, but I've been confronted with images of what's been going on in India with the spread of COVID over there. I saw the kind of videos of sort of oxygen tanks being rolled in and out for people just desperately trying to get a few breaths of air, and even those pyres across the cities of India where they're trying to just cremate the bodies of people who have passed away over there. This kind of terrible reality that's going on. And even coming off the back of Anzac Day weekend, hearing the reports of the Home Affairs Secretary, the Defence Minister here in Australia, talking about the fact that we shouldn't get too comfortable, thinking that war is not a possibility, talking about just the tensions going on currently between us and China. Strikes me, it's really this message, hard things continue to happen in our world at this particular time. Earlier this week, I got the chance to go along to a conference that was happening at a Bible college in Melbourne. It was on the book of Jeremiah, attended via Zoom, so I didn't have to travel down there. But one of the things that one of the speakers said during that conference was, she was talking about the fact that actually as you look at Jeremiah and the things that they were facing, war, that they were facing the prospect really of being refugees taken off to another land, and she was just making the point that this is normal life for a lot of people around the globe. War continues in various places around the world today. There are many who are going through that process of understanding what it feels like to be driven out from your home nation and country. Hard things happen in our world. And so really the question of this series that we're beginning today is, how do we equip ourselves? How do we handle the hard stuff when it comes? And of course, hard stuff's happening out there, but for many of us, it's happening right here, right now, right today. This last week, my family's had a couple of health scares. You probably saw Jet getting around on his crutches. For others, we have relationships that are strained or even broken. There's loved ones. For a lot of us, as we thought about it, for our church family, who we'd like to go and visit, some who've even lost loved ones through the midst of COVID and we can't be there. There are addictions that pinch on family life. There's robberies that go on in our town. I was talking to a friend here in Mackay, and he'd had these video cameras installed around his house recently. He had a problem with cats, I think it was, that he was trying to catch. But as he watched back through the footage, he saw suddenly, hang on here, there was a man and a woman, and they were testing all the doors on his house, right very close to here at Fitzgerald School, just seeing if there was an open door. He and his wife are inside sleeping. It doesn't make you feel very secure when you see that sort of thing has gone on right at your front door. And so as we think about hard things happening, there's a bunch of other questions I think that come up for us. Why do hard things happen? Is God involved in the hard things that are happening? Is there other spiritual forces that are at work? Did I do something wrong that has caused this hardship that I am presently experiencing and walking through? You might be wondering that question today. And they are questions worth asking. We'll address that in some way today, and we'll turn to that particular question in a more fuller way next week. But another question I think that comes up is, when will hardship come to me? Maybe for you today, life is pretty good. And as you hear about that hardship happening overseas, it feels very distant and far away for you. But it might be that as you hear about hardship going on for others, you kind of know that it's going to come to you one day. When's it going to come? At what time will hardship come into your life? Well, let's pray. As we open up this book of Jeremiah, we're going back to the Old Testament, and so let's pray that God would give us wisdom and speak to us this morning. Loving Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your word. And Father, as we do live in this world where really difficult and hard and troubling things do go on all the time, Father, we just pray that you would be speaking to us, that you would be helping us to understand that, this world that we live in, and Father, helping us to understand what our role is and what place you have given us in the midst of this hardship, what you want us to do. And we just pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, today, of course, we're starting a new series. We're going to be looking at Jeremiah. It's a very long book in the Old Testament, 52 chapters. We're going to try and get through it in about 5 or 6 weeks. I can't remember exactly, but very quickly. So we'll be taking some big chunks, just chapter one today. So we'll start easy and then start leaping and bounding through the book next week. But we're also going to spend some time looking at another book in the Old Testament, Lamentations, which is very closely tied to Jeremiah because they are both written at really the low point for God's people, Israel, across in the Old Testament. And so we'll spend some time in that. In Bible study groups, we're going to spend a bit more time in that particular book, Lamentations, as well as looking at some Psalms and just thinking about the different ways that God has given us permission to express ourselves to him as we go through different seasons and emotions and feelings in life. We're going to be thinking that through both here on a Sunday and also in our Bible study groups during the week for those who can get along to those. Big idea today as we look at Jeremiah 1, our time, which we're experiencing today, our time happens in the midst of God's time. And so I want to urge us, the big takeaway is to trust God with the time that he has given us. Let's have a look at this book together. I want to start with this idea of God's time. And just to give us a little bit of context as we come to the book of Jeremiah, I've got a diagram on the screen. Kind of be interested to hear up the back there. James, can you read any of that or not? Not really. You can read it? Okay, well, that's good. So some of the guys up the back can read it. You start at the top, but right back at the beginning of the Old Testament, obviously you've got Adam and Eve in the garden, but really a crucial point happens when Abraham is made those great promises from God. He will be given a land, an offspring, a great offspring, and they will be a blessed people who ultimately will bring blessing out to all the nations. If you know a little bit of the story of the Old Testament, you'll realize that didn't happen straight away. God's people went down to Egypt until Moses came along, and then he led them out of Egypt and brought them into the promised land under the reign of Joshua once Moses had passed on. The high point for God's people, Israel, really comes with King David. They continue to expand their territory. They become essentially this world superpower, and that's the point where we see a level of fulfillment to these promises that have been made to Abraham come with David and also with his son Solomon. But all the way through, God has been warning his people, if you don't keep listening to me, then I'm not going to let you be able to let you stay in the land. And so we see things after David and Solomon, they start to go downhill. There's the division of the kingdom. There's a civil war that happens. The northern kingdom, which through the Old Testament is often referred to as Israel, they get carted off into exile in Assyria in 722 BC. But during that period, once they're off in exile, the southern kingdoms, sometimes referred to as Judah in the Bible, sometimes referred to as Israel, which is really confusing, I know, but that is what happens as you read through the Old Testament. And God says to them, don't think that because I've taken the northern kingdom off that they're the bad guys, you're the good guys. No, if you don't turn and listen to my word, the same will happen to you. And so Isaiah, Micah, that's their message. And finally, you get to this figure, Jeremiah, that we're going to be thinking about. He gets the word of the Lord come to him. We're going to look at it today in Jeremiah 1, his calling to ministry, 627 BC. He preaches for 23 years, saying to God's people, if you don't turn, you're going to go to exile. And finally, in 605 BC, Babylon comes to power, and Jeremiah's message at that point changes. For the next 20 or so years, he tells them, you're going into exile, it's going to happen. And so your only hope is actually to go across here to exile, with those that the Babylonians are taking away. And so you have prophets like Ezekiel, also Daniel. They're really where God's hope lies with his people across in exile in Babylon. For those who are left back here, you'll see on the left-hand side, there's two different deportations to Babylon. There's actually a third one that happens a little bit earlier. But Jeremiah has the unfortunate job of sticking around. He doesn't get to go to Babylon, and really none of the Israelites want to go there anyway. But he's telling the people, your hope is to surrender and go across to Babylon, but his job is to stay in Jerusalem. And so he stays there right till the end, until the very final remnants of God's people, they flee off to Egypt against God's word, and Jeremiah goes off with them. And so he kind of has this pretty average context into which God calls him into ministry. All of this is important because we get this context right from the very first verses of the book. If you've got Jeremiah there, maybe on your phone, or you've got a Bible, turn up Jeremiah chapter 1 and we'll have a look just at those first couple of verses to begin with. It says, the words of Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, one of the priests at Anathoth in the territory of Benjamin. The word of the Lord came to him in the 13th year of the reign of Josiah, son of Amon, king of Judah, and through the reign of Jehoiakim, son of Josiah, king of Judah, and down to the fifth month of the 11th year of Zedekiah, son of Josiah, king of Judah, when the people of Jerusalem went into exile. And so if you keep your eyes kind of on those verses, but also I've got a diagram here on the screen just to give you a little bit of context of these kings that are being referred to here in the early chapters of Jeremiah. So Josiah, he was a relatively good king. He reigned for a long time. It's during his life that God comes and speaks to Jeremiah in the first place. He dies. His son is appointed as King Jehoahaz. He only lasts for 3 months. The rest of his sons are essentially kind of wicked and bad kings. He lasts for 3 months. Then the next son, Jehoiakim, is appointed as king. He is taken off in that first deportation to Babylon. Things don't go well for Jehoiakim. And then his son is put in place as king. He only lasts 3 months. He gets taken as well to Babylon. We actually hear about Jehoiakim. He's not mentioned here at the start of Jeremiah or either as Jehoahaz, because, I mean, they only ruled for 3 months anyway. But we hear about Jehoiakim right at the Jehoiachin, right at the end of the book of Jeremiah. There's a little bit of hope that comes at the end of the book, but we'll get there eventually. And finally, Zedekiah is the man that the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar, he put to look after the remaining people in Jerusalem. He rebelled, and so he gets taken across to Babylonia as well in the final stage of that exile. And so that's the kind of context that's happening as Jeremiah is called. And really, his message, it's a pretty bleak message. If you have a look down at verse 13, he's called as a prophet, and it seems, at least in the first chapter, partly how he receives his messages is he sees these pictures and God explains those to him. Verse 13, the word of the Lord came to me, says Jeremiah. Again, what do you see? I see a pot that is boiling, I answered. It is tilting towards us from the north. And the Lord said to me, from the north, disaster will be poured out on all who live in the land. I am about to summon all the peoples of the northern kingdoms, declares the Lord. Their kings will come and set up their thrones in the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem. They will come against her, her surrounding walls and all her towns of Judah. And I will pronounce my judgments on my people because of their wickedness in forsaking me, in burning incense to other gods and in worshipping what their hands have made. And so that is the message that really Jeremiah has to deliver. Judgment is coming, essentially, is the word that he has to speak. It is a time of judgment in God's plans and purposes in which Jeremiah has been placed. What about us? What about us as we look around the world, as we see war continuing to happen around our world, as we hear reports of the potential of war even happening for us here in Australia, as we see plagues spreading the globe, and as maybe we still hope that there might be some positive happen. For those who are Christians here this morning, we might hope that the gospel of the Lord Jesus, amidst of everything that's going on, might continue to spread, that there might be some times of renewal from the Lord. Well, it's interesting when you consider the Lord Jesus' words, because he warns us that just as there was judgment upon the earth in Jeremiah's day, he warns us to expect that it will continue to happen in our own day. Just to read a few verses from Luke chapter 21, as Jesus prepares his disciples while he was still on earth He says to them, Luke chapter 21, verse 9, "When you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away." He said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famines, pestilences," that's plagues, "in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven." Jesus is saying to us, we live in this broken, fallen world. It is a world under judgment. And we can never expect that there will be a perfect heaven on earth happen in our day, in our time, unless the Lord Jesus is to return and bring his kingdom here on earth. And at the same time, it won't be perfect. Jesus does give the expectation that the message about him will continue to spread, that people will continue to witness in his name as the Holy Spirit drives his servants forward and gives them words to speak. But this is the time that God has set us. Does that sound kind of depressing? We might wonder, what's the hope if that is what we are to expect in this world? Well, I want to show us that our time has been given in the context of God's time. He knows what he's doing. See it with Jeremiah. If you have a look at verse 4 of Jeremiah chapter 1. Here is this man who has been born into a time of judgment. Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 4. "The word of the Lord came to me saying, 'Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I set you apart. I have appointed you as a prophet to the nations.'" Do you see what God's saying to Jeremiah? Before Jeremiah was even in his mother's womb, before he had been created on this earth, God knew him. God knew the times that he had set for Jeremiah. God is saying to Jeremiah that I have placed you in this specific moment. This is your perfect time in my plans and purposes, because I have created you for this moment. All the desires that are within Jeremiah, the gifts that he has given, each circumstance that he will face as we walk through the book of Jeremiah, we'll see some of those, has been ordained and planned by the Lord. God knew him before the creation of the world, and he has given him a specific role in this world. And I want to put to us that the same is true of each and every one of us. We'll talk about how Jesus Christ himself, he came into this world at the exact moment that God planned and ordained it. He had a specific role. Even the likes of the Apostle Paul in the New Testament, he'll actually use very similar language to what Jeremiah's using here. He's kind of reflecting some of the language to talk about his own life. Before he was formed in his mother's womb, he realizes God had set him a specific task. For him, it was to be an apostle to the nations. But I want to put to us today that whoever you are here, whether you have made the choice yet or not before you came in here this morning to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, if you would come and you would say, "Jesus, I will follow you as Lord," this one who we'll talk about has laid down his life for us to restore us to the Father, then we come to a God who says to us in Jesus, if we find our fullness in him, he says, "I have put you here for a specific purpose. I have a specific plan for you. Everything that's within you, all your desires, your gifts, your skills, your personalities, every circumstance, I put you here for a reason." Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 is a great verse. It says that God has created us in Christ Jesus. If we are in Christ, if we come to Christ as our Lord and Saviour, you can do that today. Just say, "Jesus, I come and I follow you." We are created in Christ Jesus as God's workmanship to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. It's a great verse. God has prepared it all in advance. He has a plan and a purpose for you. And so you think about the desires that God has put in you, your personality, your gifts, some of the struggles that you've been through, the hard times that you have maybe already faced. God has a plan for you. He has a purpose for you. He has a reason that he has put you in this particular moment in history. There is a reason that he has got you here this morning, listening to his word as we listen to it from Jeremiah. I was at a prayer meeting this week, And there was this phrase that came up in the prayer meeting. It'll sound kind of weird. The way the person who was in the prayer meeting spoke it out was in the Hebrew text. So it's from a Psalm 118, verse 26. I'm going to read it in the Hebrew, and then I'll say it in English. Baruch haba, or haba'a, beshem Yahweh. Baruch haba, beshem Yahweh. Blessed is the one. Blessed is he or she who comes in the name of the Lord. It's a greeting. It's in Psalm 118, verse 26. And as we talked that through at this prayer meeting, the kind of reflection that came to us is that just as those who greeted Jesus as he walked into Jerusalem as he was going to die on the cross, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Well, so on one level, that's how we should treat every person that God puts into our life. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. And of course, we don't know if everyone who's coming to us is coming to us in the name of, in the Hebrew, it's the personal name, Yahweh. Jesus takes that on, and Yahweh just means I am, and Jesus says, I am, that personal name of Jesus. We don't know exactly what name people are coming to us in. But as you look at what God is saying in this chapter in Jeremiah, it is this perspective that every person who comes into your life, no matter whether they're a frustrating person or a person that you're thankful that they're in your life, there is this right perspective that we should welcome them as one that God has sent into our life. Willing to be a blessing to them, yes, but expecting that maybe God has blessing that he wants to pass on to us from them, no matter how frustrating it might be. Is it going to be easy to live out that reality? God has set us our time. He knows why he has put you on earth right now. As we take that on board, as we follow the Lord Jesus, is that going to be easy? Certainly not. See for Jeremiah across in verse 17 of Jeremiah chapter 1. This is what God says to him. Get yourself ready. Stand up and say to them, to the people of Judah, whatever I command you. Do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them. Today I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar, and a bronze wall to stand against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, its officials, its priests, and the people of the land. They will fight against you, but will not overcome you, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Do you notice how, as God explains to Jeremiah what he should expect for what becomes the next 40 plus years of his public ministry, there's kind of positives and negatives. It's a very simple job he has to do. On one level, God's going to speak to him. He just says what God gives him to speak, and that's all he has to do. It's a very easy task on one level. God promises that he'll be with Jeremiah. But do you notice as well that as God sets him on this task, he says at the same time as you speak, you're going to meet a fierce opposition. And part of the way that I've created you, Jeremiah, is so that you can be a man who can stand and take it. It is not going to be easy. But I have made you fit for the task. I've put you here for that purpose. And so we ought to expect the same for us. God will be with us. The task is not that complicated, but it will still be hard. I want to ask the question, what's our role in living out this perspective? If God has set us a specific time, in the context of his overall time, what is our role? Well, as I said at the start, big thing I want you to take away is just to trust God with your time. It's not all going to be easy, but you can trust him with it. See how Jeremiah responds and what God's counsel is to him in verse 6. Right after God has spoken these very first words to him, verse 6, Jeremiah says, "Alas, sovereign Lord, I do not know how to speak. I'm too young." Some people think that Jeremiah may have even been as young as 12 years old when he received this word from the Lord. We don't exactly know, I don't think, but he's obviously quite young. He's trying to find excuses, right? It's overwhelming. It's daunting. See what God says. But God said to me, "Do not say I'm too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord." Jeremiah's freaking out, but God says, "Your task is very simple. I will tell you where to go, and you just need to go. I'll tell you what to speak, and you just need to speak. And there'll be times when you're afraid, and maybe you won't have the words to speak because God hasn't given them. but don't be afraid because I'll be with you. He's just to trust that God will take him where he needs to be, give him the words to speak when he needs to speak, and that God will be with him, even though he might not feel that that is the case. And of course, all of that for us today is easier said than done, isn't it? And as we walk through this book, Jeremiah, and into Lamentations, we'll see some of the complexity of walking our own path in our own time, trusting God that he has put us here for this purpose. That's part of the reason for this series, is to help equip us for that, whether we're going through the hardship now or whether that's coming in the future. But you know the thing that gives us hope? I don't think any of us are going to have it as hard as Jeremiah did. And I know that none of us will have it as hard as the Lord Jesus Christ did. So he came into this world, he was so opposed that he was put to death, he was strung up on a cross. I mean, he had to carry the weight of the judgment of God for all those enemies of God on the cross. That was his path to walk, that was his time. I'm not going to have to do that. You won't have to do that. And we have that great hope that Jesus Christ, as he walked trusting his Father, he came out the other side, resurrection life. And he invites us today to join him on this path of walking before his Father, trusting that he has good plans and purposes for each and every one of us. I imagine there's probably a bunch of questions that have been raised for us even as we come to this first talk. We will have a question time, and so do jot those down, or please do ask them, because if you've got a question, it's most likely that there's others here today who have the same question, and so please give some thought about how you might try and have a go at articulating what that question is. A couple that I've got. You might at the moment be in a situation where you feel like God has given you a desire, but you don't have the context to play that out. Maybe there's people who are standing in the way that are stopping you from doing what you think it is that you were made for. Maybe there's other reasons or other circumstances that just seem to have conspired against you fulfilling what it is that you feel like God has put you on the earth for. And I mean, partly as you walk through that, part of the process will be grieving. It's a horrible thing to go through, to have a desire here and yet no context here to live out that desire. Part of that process will be grieving through. God, why have you done this? What's going on? Bringing it to God. That's the whole point of this series, is going to be as we feel like that, we bring it to the Lord. We pray through it. I do just want to talk briefly to the idea of when it is that we feel like it's a specific person whom God has put in our life who is frustrating this desire within us. Passage that came to me this week was 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 10. It expresses the reality that you see right through the New Testament. It says that we are to work towards being perfectly united in mind and thought with others. I mean, specifically, it's talking about Christians with other Christian people. But if you've come to the Lord, and specifically as you're trying to relate to other Christian people, but I think there's application for those who aren't following the Lord as well, we're to seek towards being perfectly united in mind and thought. And so you might be thinking, why on earth has God put this person in my life at this time? This seems crazy. Well, perfectly united in mind and thought. As you try and work that through and talk it through with them, that is the context in which God can work out his plans and purposes. If I can just read a proverb, I think, to kind of bring this home a little bit, this idea of relating to others. Proverbs 16:1, it says, "To humans belong the plans of the heart, but from the Lord comes the proper answer of the tongue," or the answer of the tongue. To humans belong the plans of the heart, but from the Lord comes the proper answer of the tongue. Notice it doesn't say the desires. I think we've oftentimes got to be pretty slow to write off our desires and say, well, that just must be an evil desire and that's why God hasn't given it to me. Sure, if he's spoken against that in Scripture, then yeah, it is actually something you need to repent of and turn from, like jealousy and sexual immorality, things that we've talked about through Galatians. But a lot of the desires that God has put in us are good desires. We trust that they're there for a reason. But the proverb says, as we make plans about how we think that desire should be worked out, you've got to trust that oftentimes those plans will be your plans. And if you want to know what is the Lord's will in this situation, well, one way, according to Proverbs, is to listen to the answer of the tongue, to go talk to others, yes, and hear what they have to say. But I think sometimes it's as someone comes and maybe gives you feedback on what you're wanting to pursue and push ahead with, and it's not quite lining up with your plans, well, you trust that God's put that person here for a very specific reason. And in all of that, just like Jeremiah, we're not looking to be told what to do by others, but we're constantly thinking, what is the Lord saying? What's the Lord telling me to go and do? What is the Lord wanting me to go and say? That's the question. And we'll see this interchange as we work through Jeremiah going on and think into that some more. And am I saying with this that if we can kind of just get this right, life is going to be smooth sailing? No. Jeremiah, through the book, and particularly in the early chapters of this book, as he starts to work out this calling that God has given him, there's kind of these inserted pieces through the first 20 chapters that give interchanges between him and God. As it gets to the end of Jeremiah 20, the last of those interchanges, it's kind of brutal as Jeremiah wrestles through, God, what are you doing? Why have you called me to this particular task when people are responding to me the way that they are? What are you doing, God? But you see, he did the right thing because he brought it to the Lord. He wrestled through the hardship. He grieved through it. He worked through it. And of course, he trusted God, and so we are still reading his words today. Big questions we had, we started with, how do we equip ourselves for the reality that hardship will come upon us? Why do hard things happen? When will hard things come upon us? And we've seen our time occurs in God's time. Very specific purpose. God has put you here for a reason, the exact way that he has made you. And so we need to trust God with our times. Can you kind of imagine, I don't want to give unrealistic expectations here, but can you imagine as the hard times come, that you kind of get to the point in life where you have this underlying confidence. You might be rattled on the surface, all sorts of different emotions, but you have this underlying confidence and resilience that no matter what happens, I know that God is with me. I know that he is good. I know that there's a purpose going on here. Well, it begins today by taking this moment that we are in and trusting God with it, bringing it to him, praying through your situation with him, believing that he is there with you and he wants you to engage him in the midst of that difficulty. I'm going to pray and then we'll open up for questions. And so let's pray and then we'll have some question time. Loving Father, Lord, we just come to you as we think about this book, Jeremiah. It is it's opening up tough realities for us. And Lord, we just pray that as we look at your word today and over these next few weeks, Lord, we just pray that you'd give us soft hearts to hear what you're looking to say to us. We pray that we'd have a gentleness as we talk about this with one another as well, as we grieve through difficulties. And Father, we just pray that you'd be working in us a kind of deep, deep level trust in you through whatever we're going through. And we just pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so Jaden's got the microphone. So if you've got a question, if you can put your hand up, we'll pass the microphone around to you. Goodbye to those.